Do you remember when Gollum called Dobby a gay slur? In 2003, at the MTV Movie Awards, The Lord of the Rings won the award for Best Virtual Performance. Gollum actor Andy Serkis was accepting his award, hilariously accompanied by an animated Gollum. And that's when Gollum called Dobby a f***ing f***.
Dobby likes me. Dobby's a f***ing f***.
Homophobic Gollum broke my heart. Lord of the Rings was my favourite thing in the whole wide world, and I was too gay to laugh. A few minutes later, Tattoo performed, the Russian music duo whose gimmick was that they were teenage lesbian lovers. They weren't really.
There are so many gorgeous guys here tonight, it's insane.
I know, and do you want to know the best part?
What's that?
These next two performers want nothing to do with any of them.
They were joined on stage and in the audience by a squad of schoolgirl backup dancers who stripped down to their underwear and threw their uniforms to the excited older men in the audience. That awards show was perhaps not the most liberatory queer moment of my young life. Queer people knew where we stood. The queer boys were f**ks and the young lesbians were on display for adult men to ogle. But a few months later at the MTV Video Music Awards, something different happened. Britney Spears emerged on stage from a giant wedding cake in a wedding dress singing Madonna's Like a Virgin. She was joined by Christina Aguilera, also in a wedding dress. And finally, Madonna herself surfaced. And unlike the others, she was dressed as a groom. They did their song and dance, and finally, Madonna kissed both Britney and Christina on the lips. Now, it's important to remember that this was a time before same-sex marriage was legal anywhere in the US. In fact, only a couple of countries in the world had legalized it at all, and that was only just happening now. When asked by Oprah if their VMA performance was meant to be a political statement, Madonna assured her that, nah, she'd already done all of that gay rights stuff 10 years ago. Which was true. Madonna had been a huge ally to the gay community. She was an activist in the early years of HIV, she lost loved ones to it, and she fought for our community in a time when not a lot of people were listening. I think she was lying to Oprah for whatever reason. Maybe she preferred the performance speak for itself? I don't know. Today, not a lot of people remember the Tattoo performance, and I don't think anyone remembers homophobic Gollum, but Britney and Madonna kissing at the VMAs? We all remember that. And for some, it may have been a moment of queer sexual awakening. However, a year before the performance, Britney had ended her long-term relationship with Justin Timberlake. Justin was, of course, in the audience of the performance that day, so when Britney received her kiss, the camera cut to Justin, who was very clearly like, "What the fuck is this camera doing in my face?" Because of this cut, the audience at home almost completely missed the kiss with Christina. They obviously cut to Justin to get his reaction. His ex-girlfriend on stage kissing another woman? Scandalous! Is he jealous? Is he aroused? By framing the kiss between Britney and Madonna through the lens of Britney's ex-boyfriend, not only did this moment become kind of bisexual, but also tragically misogynist and highly representative of what we would come to expect of the media's treatment of women's bisexuality. It was therefore titillation, and should always be filtered through the eyes of straight men. Despite the fact that Britney was very much straight, she went on later in the decade to produce a few more songs suggestive of her performative bisexuality, such as If You Seek Amy. The same year, 2008, Lady Gaga dropped her iconic poker face, which she revealed in interviews was about having sex with a man while thinking about having sex with a woman. MTV was continuing to explore and exploit women's bisexuality with A Shot at Love with Tila Tequila. Check out our Bi-Reality TV video for more on that. But possibly the most iconic moment of bisexual pop exploitation at the time. It felt so wrong. It felt so right. Now, let's cut to the chase. Katy Perry apparently actually did kiss a girl. However, the song is just so MTV panning to Justin Timberlake at the 2003 VMAs vibe. After the big 2003 VMAs kiss, the Washington Post reported on the fluidity of kids these days. So many of these young girls seem to think that they were bisexual or lesbian. Maybe the teenage exhibitionists were just yanking guys' chains, or hoping to prove how sexy they are, or copying Britney and Madonna, but it's also possible they were enjoying themselves. There's no way for an outsider to know. For girls in particular, this was a time when bisexuality seemed almost normalized. They were free to explore themselves, to embrace their own sexualities, but there was one catch. That exploration, that empowerment, would always be accompanied by a figurative MTV camera pointed at Justin Timberlake. The girls could play as long as they understood the boys were watching. But what did the girls want to see? Bi-girl chic was only one side of the coin. To talk about what was happening with the boys and their floppy haircuts, let's take a moment to consider the age-old question, were emos an oppressed minority? In 2006 and 2008, the Daily Mail in the UK published articles warning parents against the emo cult, which they characterized as an androgynous rebellion against the sporty, manly cultures, and warned that emo celebrated death and demanded you hurt yourself. They claimed emo was a secret cult with initiation ceremonies, and that emos believed that the Black Parade was the place they would go after they died. The 2008 emo panic actually came about as the result of a teenager taking her own life, which both her parents and the coroner blamed on the fact that 3 months earlier, she had become an emo. And remember that time Russia tried to pass legislation that would let them regulate Russian emo websites and ban people in emo clothing from entering schools and government buildings? Because apparently in 2008, emo was a threat to national stability and to the safety of teenagers. Lawmakers also accused it of cultivating bisexuality. This was the same year as Mexico's emo wars, a series of organized attacks on emo teenagers at the plazas where they were known to hang out, primarily by metalheads, punks, and skaters, but also sports fans. During the first riot in Querétaro, 800 attackers beat up the emos that didn't manage to flee. Police in anti-riot gear came too late to really do anything. The attack was organized online, and several schools cancelled classes after another online call to action, Death to the Emos, threatened to clean up Mexico. Anti-emo attacks spread to several other cities too. In one instance, an emo boy was grabbed by a bunch of guys and held down while they cut off his hair. One of the attackers in Mexico told a local TV station that it bothers him that emos look more like girls than boys. Another told NPR,
"We are against these guys because they just got here and it's just a style. They don't have any ideology. Besides, they're all bisexual. We're all punks and anarchists here, so we aren't homophobic, but these guys make me sick."
The attacks were attributed to several different factors by local journalists and sociologists. One, in subcultural circles, newly emerged emos were seen as superficial copycats. Two, emos were associated with being middle class, while their attackers were supposedly working class. And three, there was definitely a strong undercurrent of homophobia to the attacks. A journalist who interviewed some of the emos described them as follows. "They are boys, but most of them are chattering like young girls. Their voices pitched and nasal, their mannerisms effeminate. I can hear them refer playfully to one another as chica and hermana, girl and sister." They told him that the attacks happened because lots of emo boys were bi and gay. LGBT rights organizations and news websites also covered the attacks and organized a demonstration for better protection of emo youth. This solidified the connection between emos and queerness and proved that emo allowed teenagers room to explore their sexuality and play around with androgyny. Their association with queerness also put emos in danger in several other countries. In Egypt, conservatives criticized emos for being disciples of Satan and homosexuals. And in Saudi Arabia, 10 emo girls were arrested by the religious police, and their parents had to sign pledges that the girls would not repeat their offensive un-Islamic behavior and dress. In Baghdad, emo flourished as an emblem of greater social freedom, but the Interior Ministry condemned it as satanic, and emos faced threats and violence. At least one person, though possibly several dozen people, were killed. So why was everyone so freaked out by a bunch of emo kids? Around the 1980s, punk was beginning to establish itself as a genre. Punk began in the UK as a reaction to the economic and political conditions of the Thatcher era. It was angry, DIY, British, non-hierarchical, working class, and masculine as hell. In America, the hardcore genre emerged inspired by British punk, but came from the middle-class white suburbs, though it was still fueled by an opposition to their parents' conservatism. In theory, these punk and hardcore scenes held egalitarian beliefs about gender, but in practice, most of the bands and audiences were men, and the shows were super macho environments and often violent, which wasn't very inviting for most women. The first wave of emo came about in this time, born out of this hardcore scene and as a direct response to it. Instead of addressing politics, emo lyrics turned inwards and discussed personal issues such as relationships and, well, emotions. Emotions. I get it. In contrast with punk, emo was more technically adept and lyrically complicated. There was more of an emphasis on melody and singing instead of shouting, and basically, they kind of sounded like chicks. The culture of emo was overall more feminine. It was often associated with veganism and straight edge. And we all know you're not a real man if you don't, you know, chug beer and eat roadkill with your bare hands. Hence my choice to transition. But emo was doing all this on purpose. It was a conscious rebellion against the strict norms of masculinity in the hardcore scene, and the macho punks weren't particularly happy about it. The members of the hardcore 90s band 18 Visions were studying cosmetology and working at fashion boutiques and hairdressers, and are often credited with popularizing clean vocals, tight trousers, and fancy hair in hardcore. They would get in fights at shows because of their feminine image. Emo was derided by hardcore fans as less authentic, as having sold out, as girly. No one wanted to be called emo.
Nathan quoted as saying emo is a pile of shit.
Oh shit, yes.
And if emo was already seen as girly sellout crap before the commercial explosion of emo in the 2000s, well, they were in for a hell of a ride. In the 2000s, My Chemical Romance, Fall Out Boy, and Panic at the Disco, who are now considered to be the holy emo trinity, all came to fame with the help of a newfangled device called the internet. This new generation of emo musicians were well aware of their image as feminine and gay, and they embraced both. They would make jokes on their blogs about being gay and fighting over makeup. On stage, band members would kiss and get freaky with one another during concerts. For instance, Brendan Urie would famously kiss guitarist Ryan Ross on stage as part of the performance. So fans were creating slash fics about these band members, and the bands were fully aware of it. Some of the musicians would also talk about kissing men in their private lives or describe their sexuality in a vague enough way that people saw them as bi. But in reality, these were overwhelmingly straight men, some of whom were married to women. Even Brendan Urie didn't come out until long after this era of emo was over. This was a straight man's game, but with a very gay performance, giving the emo aesthetic overall a very bisexual vibe. And this bisexual reputation didn't just define the bands, but also the fandom. If you asked any teen in the 2000s, they would tell you that all emos are bisexual or pretending to be bisexual. It was a mostly teen subculture in which bisexuality wasn't just okay, it was kind of expected. When you think emo, you probably think bisexual boys kissing, also depression, MySpace, androgynous all-black fashion, skinny jeans, graphic tees, Vans, flat ironed floppy hair, a lot of eyeliner. But this was not so much the look of emo bands as the look of emo fans. The bands were sometimes theatrical and androgynous in their own way, but unlike, for example, punk or metal, where the performers and the fans often look the same, the stereotypical emo aesthetic was defined by the fans rather than the bands. Emo as a genre was considered cringe, and bands didn't want to be associated with it. Emo was seen as too mainstream. Their fans were girls. They didn't even really sound all that similar to one another, so how could that be a genre? And actually, what really defined and solidified the emo label was the backlash against emo, the fights in Mexico, the Daily Mail freaking out about the Black Parade afterlife and so on. As international media reported about anti-emo violence around the world, and as emos from the UK to Mexico to Russia were organizing protests to defend themselves, the term emo, previously so vague and contested, suddenly took a very tangible shape. Conservative paranoia around emo also gave the genre subcultural capital. If the Daily Mail is so bothered that they are making up ridiculous lies about your group to discredit you, you must be doing something right. Maybe emo wasn't a dirty sellout after all. Maybe emo was rebellious and subversive. So regardless of the fact that emo didn't necessarily have a distinct sound, and regardless of the fact that most of the musicians were just straight men, emo and the queerness surrounding it was validated by the fans and the world's response to those fans. Moral panic and homophobia in large part defined emo and solidified it. What we seem to be left with is a group of mostly straight guys who accidentally became the face of a queer movement. So, that's a bit weird. In the 1980s, gay male beauty standards began to change. With the advent of HIV, the androgyny of the 70s and glam rock was pushed aside to make way for a buff butch aesthetic, which was meant to signal good health, suggesting the person wasn't HIV positive. There wasn't a lot of room in gay spaces for men who didn't look like Abercrombie and Fitch models. So by the early 2000s, not only was the heterosexual masculinity of the time very macho, so were the gay beauty standards. And emo was the opposite of that. Just like the 70s glam rockers, emos were skinny. Boys and girls dressed the same, wore the same makeup, and styled their hair in the same ways. A lot of the emo musicians were very open about their nerdy, uncool teenage years. They weren't the popular jocks, they were the kids the jocks bullied. Brian M. Peters claims that emo rejects both straight and gay masculinities, and passionately blurs all lines of gender, sexuality, and genre. Emos don't fit into gay spaces because they're too feminine and too alternative, but they don't need to. Emo challenges the limiting boundaries of gay identity politics and creates its own queer subculture. But that's the fans. That's the culture of the fandom. It was definitely responding to the aesthetic of the musicians, but didn't exactly reflect what the musicians were saying. Emo musicians seemed to be rejecting normative masculinity and gender roles, but were they? In their music videos, they would often play high school losers who want to get the girl but can't. They get made fun of by real rockers for basically not embodying enough toxic masculinity. They portray touching stories of weirdo outcasts, and they directly address teenagers who feel like they don't fit in. While people have noted that, in general, women are less sexualized in emo videos than they are in other popular music videos at the time, I don't think that was some grand gesture of feminist enlightenment. Women just played a different role in emo. Keeping in line with emo's confessional and sensitive core, women in emo lyrics and videos are usually love interests, an object of either desire or misery. Sometimes women are the prize in wish fulfillment narratives where the unlikely nerdy hero gets the girl. When it came to sex, things were quite conservative. When band members talked about their escapades, it was all pretty tame. Pete Wentz said he would kiss anyone, but was much more reserved about below the waist stuff. He didn't want to have to tell his future wife he'd slept with a bunch of people. In the music, there was this cruel girl, good girl dichotomy where female sexuality is vilified and a girl being promiscuous makes her evil. It's fascinating how this marker of softer masculinity, which does not reduce women to sexual objects and craves real intimacy, directly leads to demonizing women for enjoying sex for its own sake or having sex with multiple partners. Despite all the claims about subverting gender roles, when it comes to relationships, emo music is pretty conventional. There are a lot of songs about horrible, evil women who cheated on their boyfriends and different ways they should be punished for it. What a shame the poor groom's bride is a whore. Wonderfully sensitive men, really revolutionizing gender roles. A lot of emo is rooted in revenge fantasies and healing old playground wounds, and a big part of that is getting the girl. All of those narratives of the outcast boys who get or should get the girl instead of a jock, the underlying message is that the outcast guy is a better choice precisely because of his different masculinity, his sensitivity, his emotional openness, him being in touch with his feminine side. Is portrayed as making him a superior partner to the Neanderthal jocks. Got more wit, a better kiss, hotter touch, a better than any boy you'll ever meet, sweetie, you had me. This is not so much a gender revolution as it is beta male misogyny. So then what's the function of all this boy-on-boy action? Most of the naughty celebs we've discussed, from Gerard Way to Katy Perry to Britney and Madonna, have retroactively been accused of queerbaiting. Queerbaiting is a way of bringing in queer viewers by, for example, implying queer characters or relationships are going to happen and then never bringing that to fruition. But importantly, This has to be deliberate on the part of media producers. Queerbaiting is a marketing strategy. It's not queerbaiting if fandom just latches onto a character or a ship that producers never intended to use for queerbaiting. In queerbaiting, the promised queer content is never delivered. It's a hint, an implication, and it's often meant to only be noticed by LGBT audiences while flying under the radar for straight viewers, because ultimately, the point of queerbaiting is to speak to queer fans without alienating the homophobic audiences. And when it comes to the peculiar pop star bisexuality of the noughties, none of this was in any way subtle. There were no secret messages, no broken promises. Bisexuality was overt, it was the core pull, and just as importantly, it wasn't done for LGBT fans. It was very overtly for the straights. To say the emos and Katy Perrys of the era were queerbaiting would be to completely misunderstand the intent and the context. Queerbaiting is an intentional marketing strategy because, at the end of the day, the entertainment industry is all about making money, and in the noughties, queer media wasn't profitable for the mainstream. 2009's Jennifer's Body was an interesting example of this, a horror film about two best friends, Jennifer and Needy, who clearly had a romantic and sexual element to their relationship.
You're totally lesbian gay.
We look back on it now as a queer cult classic, but at the time, it was a massive flop, and the feminist and queer elements were seen as pandering to a straight male audience, despite the fact that they weren't. But at the time, we were incapable of seeing this through any lens besides a straight one, and primarily a male one. So this footage of two women kissing was not even seen as queer to begin with. The noughties couldn't conceive of a bisexuality that wasn't meant for a straight audience. Queer people weren't even considered a mainstream market. Queerbaiting as a term only gained popularity in the 2010s, which makes sense. It was a decade in which a lot of countries legalized same-sex marriage, a time of shifting public perceptions and a growing mainstream acceptance of LGBT community. Producers were starting to notice the spending power of the LGBT community, which would, by the end of the decade, be the equivalent of a whole country. They were testing the boundaries of how much they can give us without alienating the straights. This is also the era of producers exploiting the free online labor and free promotion only fandoms can provide, and nothing engages fandoms more than a juicy ship. In the 2010s, queerbaiting just makes sense, culturally and financially. But honestly, my co-writer Ada and I reckon mainstream Western media has mostly left queerbaiting behind now. In the 2020s, it's just more profitable to have openly LGBT characters. Nowadays, queerbaiting will get you Twitter ire, while LGBT characters will get you a lot of praise, attention, and money, even if your product is fucking terrible. And in the age of streaming services, you don't have to worry so much about offending mainstream audiences. Netflix can platform transphobia and transpositivity at the same time, and we just get to pick which one we prefer. We tend to think of queer representation as something sparse, that we need every crumb we can get, but GLAAD has been tracking the number of LGBT characters on American TV for the last few decades, and we went from less than 2% LGBT characters in 2005 to 12% now. Even Marvel films and friggin' Fantastic Beasts, both notorious for promising gay characters and then chickening out, finally put them on the screens this year. The poster child for queerbaiting, Supernatural, made that one guy who had to come out as straight confess his love for that guy whose face doesn't move. In the 2020s, we get actual LGBT characters because that's not only socially acceptable, but often very profitable to do. Representation isn't a thing of social justice, it's just good business. We're here, we're queer, do you want my fucking money or not? The 2020s are too late for queerbaiting, and the noughties were just too early for it. So if the noughties' bisexuality wasn't queerbaiting, then what was it? Well, the truth is, bisexuality was fashionable. Obviously, the idea that bisexuality is just trendy is an excuse used to dismiss people's bisexuality, and that's horrible and biphobic, but it's not mutually exclusive with the fact that every now and again, humanity rediscovers bisexuality and decides it's super exciting and sexy, and suddenly lots of celebrities seem to be bisexual and everyone has something to say about it. Usually this happens in the times when gender and sexuality norms are being challenged, such as the 1920s. Yes, it's literally been over a century of this bisexuality as fashionable business. In the 1920s, the rebellion against Victorian propriety, the popularization of Freud, and a general predilection for the daring and unconventional led women to cut their hair and embrace an androgynous silhouette. Mainstream venues hosted very popular drag balls, celebrities embraced a sexy androgyny, and a lot of people were dipping their toes into bisexuality and non-monogamy. People wanted to rebel, to live dangerously, to do things that would shock and confuse their parents. Those basic bitches are gonna stay home tonight while you go to a drag ball, because your understanding of gender is just so much more evolved. And maybe afterwards, you might want to hop into bed and try some of those scandalous bisexual things Freud was writing about. Bisexuality, naturally paired with androgyny, became a symbol of both freedom and transgression. And that's the key trait that defines every era of the mainstream's fascination with bisexuality, with Bisexual Chic. Probably the most famous era of the Bisexual Chic was the 1970s. In May 1974, both Time magazine and Newsweek reported that bisexuality was now suddenly in style. It was a post-Stonewall world. It was the sexual revolution. The DSM had recently removed homosexuality as a mental disorder. Being gay was maybe actually kind of okay. The Time and Newsweek articles credited increasing androgyny in fashion and feminism blurring gender roles with inciting this new bisexual chic.
Ladies and gentlemen, and others.
Time speculated that sex research emphasizing the importance of the clitoral, am I allowed to say that word? Orgasm, am I allowed to say that word? Maybe changing how people saw sex. David Bowie and Elton John both came out as bisexual, at least for the duration of the 70s. Glam rock was in style, and as with the hippie movement, the aesthetics of it blurred gender lines. While it may have seemed fashionable to be bi, the media interest in Bisexual Chic leaned significantly more toward the fashion and the pop stars of the era, while bi activists continued to be ignored or even shunned. Inevitably, the hype passed. Bisexuals continued to be bisexual, but the media didn't seem to think it was hip anymore, especially with the coming of AIDS. The 70s were a time for social change, as would be the noughties on a smaller scale, the decade of mainstreaming the battle for same-sex marriage. It was perhaps inevitable that pop culture would once again become fixated on bisexuality. Katy Perry has spoken about how I Kissed a Girl was produced as she was leaving behind a very straight, anti-gay, conservative Christian upbringing. It felt so wrong. It felt so right. It's not what good girls do. And that is why it's fun and hot. As Garber points out, the exciting, guilty pleasures of transgressing, of intruding, and spying, and misbehaving added to the eroticism of the occasion, giving permission to break a rule, as many parents learn, does not always give pleasure, and in fact, might take the desired pleasure away. I Kissed a Girl could never be queerbaiting because this song wasn't written for queer people. It was written from Katy Perry's rebellion against her parents and then filtered through Dr. Luke's creepy male gaze. And sometimes Bisexual Chic is used to make a political statement. Madonna, Britney, and Christina were definitely making a statement about marriage, but that's not really what people remember today. We remember that it was scandalous, it was sexy, it made headlines and pissed lots of people off, but that's what made it cool. The intended audience would enjoy the outrage. Bisexual Chic lets you piss off the right people in a cool rock star way. The audiences at the time understood that. It's no surprise that it was conservative outrage that finally solidified emo's meaning and social capital, and the bands reveled in it. When My Chemical Romance were bottled at rock festivals in 2006 and 2007, Gerard Way said it was their greatest victory, because it proved that music was getting dangerous again. Pete Wentz said of his experiences making out with guys, "When I said that I make out with dudes, there was a slight sense of sexual rebellion in that, and I probably even made it a bigger deal than it was." A part of it is probably also that some straight men just happen to be gender nonconforming, and that reads as queer to most people, including LGBT people, but also to homophobes. And embracing the fact that they are being grouped in with LGBT people is often the best defense for androgynous men. There is a sense of self-empowerment, of recapturing who you are by people calling you a f*** and being like, yeah, I am a f***, even though you're not. On the one hand, guys openly acknowledging and enjoying their own femininity and associating themselves with gayness definitely helped destigmatize those things. But on the other hand, it was always a performance, sometimes a joke. It was tongue-in-cheek, and the humor came from attributing queer or feminine properties to men. The early emo fans talked about it in the same way. Gerard Way not being able to grow a beard was funny, but also endearing. The boys kissing and cuddling was cute, and it was hot and fueled a lot of fanfiction and speculation. You can still find massive online compilations of clues pieced together from the band's blog posts, photos, and quotes and timelines that are supposed to prove tortured secret romances happening backstage and on tour buses. Marjorie Garber writes about the parallels between bisexuality and the institution of celebrity, and how the truly iconic stars have a bisexual quality about them, and how exciting a celebrity's bisexuality is for the public because it means everyone can imagine that they have a chance with them. It also makes a celebrity seem more intriguing, gives them a story. We do tend to follow what celebrities say as if their comings out somehow validate our sexualities, all the while nervously hoping they don't change their minds and prove the haters wrong. The fact that there are more openly LGBT celebrities now than there have ever been before is a sign of positive social change. But the truth is, because of the nature of the entertainment industry, it will always end up being turned into headlines, into fodder for clicks and sales. Celebrities coming out isn't bad, we just can't rely on it to liberate us. That's also the biggest issue with Bisexual Chic, how firmly it's limited to celebrity and to performativity. It celebrates bisexuality and androgyny, glorifies them as a symbol of freedom and transgression, of the times changing, of something daring and beautiful. But bisexuality being celebrated as a symbol, as a performance, as an abstract concept, can only help the rest of us so much. The noughties were a very bisexy time, but also a time that insisted bisexuals didn't exist. That's not surprising. Ever since the 1920s, Bisexual Chic had double standards for celebrities and civilians. What is pathologized in the clinic is celebrated on the stage and at the box office. In fact, bisexuality, which is so difficult to pinpoint in life, is perfectly recognizable as a performative mode. And yes, emo helped bisexual and queer kids find each other and build a community, but that was their work, them reading the symbols and turning them into something a bit more tangible. Emo fandom wasn't the same as a bisexual organization or a community that could offer them support and resources. When emos in Mexico were beaten up, it was LGBT organizations, social workers, sociologists, and even politicians who stood up for them. And yet a lot of people have said that I Kissed a Girl helped them discover their sexuality, and that's great. But we have to acknowledge that that wasn't the real intention. It was a side product of fans' misinterpretations or reinterpretations. Panic at the Disco's biphobic song Girls, Girls, Boys, which Yuri wrote about by girls he considered to be bisexuals and about a threesome he had with them, was reinterpreted by fans to be bi-positive. But author Grace Perry talks about a very specific trauma of queer millennial women who grew up in a time that was telling them that bisexuality doesn't exist and that girls only kiss girls to turn men on. She says that even while she was secretly kissing her high school best friend, she was not just unwilling, but unable to even conceive of the notion that she might be anything other than straight, because in her mind, that was the only respectable and real option. There were gay communities and gay media as well, for sure, but there wasn't really space for bisexuals in them. A lot of ink has already been spilled over how biphobic and transphobic the L word was. Lesbian media such as Diva magazine didn't really talk about bisexuality, and on the rare occasion they would publish anything semi-neutral about bi woman, a war would erupt in the letters section, with brave confessionals such as a gay woman, I wouldn't touch a bisexual woman with a barge pole. None of the real woman-identified lesbians I know have given up hope of finding a partner and slept with the enemy. I don't know why you continue to publish letters and waste space from so-called bisexual women carping on about being bisexual. Let them stew in their males' juices and leave us real lesbians to get on with it. Males' juices. Bisexual women were talked about in very demeaning terms, usually defined by graphic descriptions of what they do with men. Bisexuality is not allowed to be a whole unique, humanized sexual orientation. Bisexuals are always defined by their partners. This sort of attitude was also normalized among gay men and even gay and lesbian activists. In 2002, sociologist Daniel Weltzer Lang went to a gay conference and had the attendants fill out a survey on their opinions about bisexuals. These were the intellectual and activist elite of gay and lesbian communities, and this is what they had to say about bisexuals. They're hypocritical, unfaithful, two-faced, uptight, cold, pains in the neck, turncoats, self-important, trendy, heterosexual, capricious, and frigid. Hey now, I may be hypocritical and uptight, cold, pain in the neck, capricious, and trendy, but I am definitely not heterosexual. That is just rude. Some of the activists had neutral or positive opinions about bisexuality, but those often verged on idealizing bisexuality as the vanguard orientation that will bring us liberation and peace on Earth. So bisexuality is again reduced to a symbol, just like with Bisexual Chic. Bisexuality is only allowed to exist in some mythical past or utopic future, as an ideal or a conspiracy, but never as an embodied sexuality of boring everyday people. Celebrities like Pete Wentz, who was very openly not bisexual, were constantly accused of being secretly bi. When Wentz married Ashley Simpson, the media was full of articles warning his wife about his cross-dressing tendencies and about how his religious in-laws found out about his bisexuality and lost their shit. Musicians who were actually out as bi since the start of their careers, such as Swedish glam rocker Ola Salo, on the other hand, were accused of lying about their sexuality and only doing it for Bisexual Chic. When Salo married a woman, people took it as a confirmation that, see, he was straight the whole time. All of this is to say there wasn't actually a lot of space for bisexuality in either the straight mainstream or the gay community, so it's not a surprise that naughty's bisexual teens latched onto emo. Vice published an interesting exploration of why so many former emos are now into K-pop, and cites gender nonconformity and physical affection between band members as one of the main factors that define the appeal of both genres. But just as emo's bisexuality and androgyny were mainly performative, seeing K-pop idols as feminine and homoerotic is a cross-cultural misinterpretation at best, and kind of racist at worst. Both emo and K-pop are just enough outside of the American mainstream that you have to be intentional about standing them, but at the same time, they're both popular enough to amass huge fandoms and grace the covers of teen magazines. In other words, emo probably appealed to people who were looking for something that felt slightly alternative while still being pretty mainstream, to those who were attracted to fandoms and willing to reinterpret content as more subversive than it really is because they crave bisexuality and gender subversion but won't or can't find the real thing elsewhere. Some of the teenagers who grew up listening to noughties emo went on to spearhead the new generation of the genre, sometimes called emo revival. The late Lil Peep, a pioneer of emo rap, was openly bi, and this new fusion of emo and rap opened doors for more musicians who are people of color, openly bi, women, or all of the above. Bisexual musicians who are actually bi. We're truly living in the future. It's interesting to see Machine Gun Kelly and Willow Smith team up for the song Emo Girl, which is pretty clearly about Megan Fox, even going so far as to describe her outfit and Jennifer's body and use a soundbite from the film.
I am a god.
The lyrics are very basic and aren't really representative of anything to do with the emo tradition of introspection or even misogynist revenge fantasies. It reminds me more of Ping Pong Girl from Crazy Ex-Girlfriend than anything from noughties emo. Ping Pong Girl! And what's with, she only dates guys with the big. I think you missed the point. Emo girls may have liked big ones, but they wanted to see you suck it, Mr. Machine Gun. But it's really interesting to see an actual bi woman singing an emo song about a woman. Back in the day, women's bisexuality had its place, and that place wasn't really emo music, not to mention how white emo was. Jennifer's Body has seen a renaissance. It found its audience in an era when bisexuality is definitely seen as more legitimate, and women's bisexuality isn't as often presumed to be for the male gaze. Though we still have a weird perception of where Bisexual Chic ends and queerbaiting begins. Harry Styles has been accused of queerbaiting and of appropriating a queer aesthetic. It's funny to see The Guardian be like, there's a popular perception that you don't define as straight, the lyrics to your songs, the clothes you choose to wear, even the sleeve of your new record. All of these things get picked apart for clues that you're bisexual. Take the album sleeve for Fine Line, with its horizontal pink and blue stripes, a splash of magenta. The design seems to gesture at the trans and bisexual pride flags, which is great, unless the person behind it happens to be a straight dude sprinkling LGBTQ crumbs that lead nowhere. First of all, claiming only queer people can be gender nonconforming is an unbelievably conservative and counterproductive approach. Second, both Styles and one of his designers have been very open about the influence of Bowie on his look. The reason why people look at Styles and think he looks bisexual is because he's emulating Bowie at the peak of Bisexual Chic. But Bisexual Chic is not in the leftist Twitter vocabulary, so we get queerbaiting instead. Thirdly, blue and pink are common colours in the world. Måneskin have also been accused of queerbaiting, both for their fashion and their stage kisses. But it seems like some context is missing. Two guys kissing on stage at a Hard Rock festival in 2002, or an Italian band using their screen time on Polish television now to make a statement about LGBT rights, is entirely different from performers kissing in a gay club in San Francisco.
We think that everyone should be allowed to do this without any fear. Thank you, Poland. Love is never wrong.
It doesn't mean that Måneskin aren't also heavily leaning into Bisexual Chic, because they're into Bowie, half the band is bi anyway, and because it's hot and their audience loves it. But it's definitely more complicated than just queerbaiting. We have a complex relationship with Bisexual Chic. On the one hand, it so often seems to invalidate the experiences of real life everyday bisexuals and encourages this image of bisexuality as performative and a passing fad. But at the same time, it can send a powerful message. It can be a sign of social change. And weirdly, no matter what TikTok tells you about cuff jeans, it's the oldest and most recognizable kind of bisexual fashion that we have. The problem with Bisexual Chic is its limitations. It's limited to the sphere of celebrity, of entertainment, of bisexuality being a symbol tied to the past or utopic future. Because of how the media landscape has changed since the deeply misogynist 2000s, we don't see much of the male gazy Bisexual Chic anymore. Grace Perry notes that even on the occasion that we do, it's more of an annoyance than something that will scar a whole generation, simply because it's outnumbered by the media that does take queer women into account as an audience. Ada and I also think that media that isn't trying to emulate I kissed a girl type pandering is sometimes accused of it, because just like with Jennifer's body, that's the lens we're used to reading it through. I'm 50-50 and I'm never gonna hide. Bisexual Chic is a language of entertainment, and while it will not in and of itself liberate us, a lot of bisexuals, both audiences and musicians, like Bisexual Chic because it's hot and it's fun. Whatever, you know, they can kiss. Harry Styles can use blue and pink. I give him permission. So are we now in the 2020s experiencing another Bisexual Chic? Well, I think only hindsight can really tell. I'll make a follow-up video 15 years from now, and I'll let you know how it goes. I only hope that next time Gollum is on MTV, it's because he's making bisexual emo rap music. One can dream. In the meantime, if you'd like to support this channel and get some exclusive content at the same time, please check out my Patreon, consider supporting. Otherwise, please like and subscribe, that'd be really helpful. Thanks to all my patrons, and a special thanks to Angela, Eric Parkinson, Chris Endicott, Corwin Found, Fluffy Bunny Boo, Gamer Guy J, Gwenda Euphoria, Helena Varvarousis, Infinite Waterfall, Machina X Domina, Matheta, Non-Anonymous, Siobhan, Stephen Wallace, Tasha Heim, Wix, Erin, Alice, Alina Vera, Amelia D, Anya Steven, Anna S, Arden, Ariotte, B, Ben Hengst, Beslaf, Beth Hershey, Break Every Yoke, Bump Girl, Kane Friedman, Katrina Lexi, Charis Edwards, Chloe Strange, Claire, Comfort and Adam, Connor Thompson, Deanna McMillan, Dorothy, Dropout Ninja, Eden Ladley, Erie Enby, Ellie Cannard, Elsie Astro, Emery James Fairgrieve, Evergarden Wall, Fafelania, Fancy Angles, Felixer of Life, Gabriella Day, Gavin Salmon, Gerald Brenter, Ghosts and You Might Die, Ginger, Grace Robertson, Grisa Alefarben, Hairball Oracle, Hellfrog, Hilda Mangold, Jackie King of Thieves, Jem Kwasowski, Jennifer Fronister, Jessage, Gillian D, Jules Inkwell, Juliana Baca, Julio Mendez, Juniper Lopez, Kale, Kate and Jess, Katie B, Kate Bollinger, Kata, Kelani Garcia, Kelly Flynn, Kisa, Kyle Denley, Lacey Cox, Lindsay Mercer, Lisa Spitalovitz, Marla, Math Class Warfare, McKenning Wood, Mike Bucket, Miss Mad, Mizaka Demizan, Muxi, Moshe Gordon Radian, Runmae Salil, Mirren McGlynn, Nat Jordan, Neve, Nico, Nick Snary, Nina, Noe, Oxy, Ossian Matthew, Pani Lin, Pseudo Pac-Man, Queer Aesthetic, Radical Planning, Rebecca Peacock, River Haddock, Rock the Shell, Sabina Ehrensberger, Sarah R, Savrid Musin, Soya Donk, Shuxtopia, Shaved Headed Bi, She Algorithm, Simon Patience, Sithvich, Soy, Straw Fox, Summertime Killer, Susie S, The Children of Jack Acid, Thea King, Thomas O'Shagan Halajin, Tia Till, Tina Gigya, Tom Harrison, Troy Zaire, Verlux, Vicious Panda, Vince Whitaker, Wandering Sock, Wards, Will O'Connor, Jonathan Zunger, and Yuli Themstedt.